Hi, good evening. This is Gil Santos. Welcome back to Talk to Harry. We have been talking for the past 30 minutes all about federalism, how the youth looks at all the issues affecting us all in this coming election, May 9. And we're going to talk further about the other issues we believe are relevant to the lives of our own people and the existence of our country, including our foreign relations, in the next segment. Let me ask you now, Iner, what does the issue on the economy bear down on the present campaign? Well, how do you look at it?
It boils down to jobs. You know?
To simplify, yeah?
To simplify it, you know, what programs of government, you know, that can stimulate employment. So with I'm very happy to see that one candidate seemed to have a better and more inclusive program to be able to employ more people, because employment is not just about you know, handouts and
yes.
You know, they talk a lot about poor peace and all that, but it's employment that gives dignity to the person. And this is what I think one of the candidates, Mayor Duterte, seemed to have better program for this. Like, for example, you know, every after board examinations, bar examinations, you'll always, of course, be flooded with new applicants,
yes,
you know,
yes.
Graduates. So we are proposing for something like an OJT for lawyers and for even one particular area where we are lacking in employment, are agriculturists.
Okay, so you're talking here of human resource upgrading and
yes.
development,
exactly.
Which means education.
Yes,
yeah.
Yes.
But there is also one aspect of employment, and this is to attract direct foreign investments so that you can have the capital that goes into the generation of jobs. Government cannot generate jobs.
What attracted investors to China was because of their workers. No, the labor
yes.
is cheap, and you know, although they speak a different language than ours, you know, we are a natural magnet for employing people. It's just upgrading the skills, retooling on the skills that we need to focus on.
Yes.
So. In terms of attracting investment, it's actually the rule of the thumb is predictability. You know, businesses look at stability, predictability, and peace and order, of course, is the
yes.
bottom line.
And
this is one of the programs of Mayor Duterte. In reading through his program,
yes.
this is something that I think attracted many people in seeing that he has a concrete program. That addresses this program. So we have, you know, candidates talk about SUCs, you know, no tuition and all that
yes.
sort of things.
Yeah.
Having been a college president,
yeah.
that's no solution.
Yeah.
Because after all, you know, the teachers need to upgrade their salaries and all that. No, and the government cannot, you know, it cannot sustain that kind of thing.
And
you know?
And what I'm asking really our voters is the fact that they should ask, if they hear a candidate, he's going to do this and do that and do that. They must ask, how are you going to fund it? Because it's going to cost our taxpayers.
Exactly.
Us all,
yes.
you know.
Yes.
How much is it going to be in terms of indebtedness of even the unborn children yet?
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
Because you can only fund governments with two ways. One is direct taxation, and the other is borrowing. And
that's right.
and you have to have a cap on the borrowing, you know.
You know, this is really pathetic to hear candidates talk about removing income tax, you know,
yeah.
and removing income tax to the without income, you know. It makes no sense.
Yeah.
But
you've got the Greek cliff.
Well, that's great.
Yeah.
So actually, there are ways, you know, that the candidate Duterte has really had come out specifically with programs
okay.
like, look, we have more than 100 SUCs, state universities and colleges. They can serve as a laboratory for new
yes.
Skills training or for doing research.
Mm-hmm.
And as such, you know, they can. It will be something that has not been explored before. By doing this, we can find partners mm-hmm. all over the world. No, mm-hmm. especially with our ASEAN partners.
Yes,
we are heavy into teaching because manpower training mm-hmm. is one essential strength of our country that need a little more honing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and hopefully with proper presentation, we can be partners with the whole world in training their...
Let me ask Gilier, mm-hmm. How does the youth now think? Are they thinking in terms of what they will be in 10 years? Or what's the futuristic outlook mm-hmm. of your generation? Because there are jobs that are available now where mm-hmm. the Filipinos can excel.
Yes.
Tourism is one of them. Mm-hmm. Caregiving is another. Mm-hmm. Health. Could be it as well, you know. You name it,
mm-hmm.
and when we speak the English language, it's more acceptable than the mm-hmm. Japanese English, the Korean English, Singaporean English, and so forth. You know,
yes.
how do you take that?
Well, in terms of planning, the youth of the day is also gearing to a short term and a long term plan.
Mm-hmm.
When we talk about short term planning, we actually since nowadays, the youth seem to be very impatient. So if we feel something that's not right and it's not done mm-hmm. in a manner that we want it to be, we tend to have this sense of impatience. In terms of long-term planning, like in a 10-year span, maybe we would gear more to the more realistic goals that we would want to achieve. Like, for example, what would happen after 6 years mm-hmm. of whoever wins will still be in this current situation, or will we be progressing to another like a similar state country like the Singapore?
Mm-hmm.
In the institution I've been in, Manila Titana Colleges, we're actually preparing as well to the skills. Let me also pick up one
go
thing.
Ahead,
yeah,
go ahead.
The skills like in terms of training, since in the advent of K-12, we are trying to hone also students' skills in terms of their like whichever machinery they would want to manipulate mm-hmm. or in terms of caregiving. So
that's almost like multitasking. Huh?
Yes, multitasking mm-hmm. as well. And what's nice nowadays is that there are so many options that the mm-hmm. youth could come to.
Mm-hmm.
Like after K-12, they could work already. But
yes.
sometimes the problem is certain institutions would
yes.
not want undergraduates to be employed. So
see,
maybe
yeah.
there should have this integration mm-hmm. of the academia and the industry as well.
Do you feel there's not enough integration now between mm-hmm. the academe and the industries?
Well, since the product of K-12 has yet to be produced,
yes.
like in 2018, I believe so, there is still much work to do.
Mm-hmm.
Like nowadays, when we see and when we have job fairs in our institution, they would still go for students or for newly graduates that has certain skills or certain experience. But how come that they would have experience when they're not employed yet? So
uh-huh, yeah.
that's the mismatch. That
so it's the on-the-job training really that will count.
Yes,
huh?
And okay. the on-the-job training, and the student must really do good with that.
Mm-hmm. Well, in Europe, mm-hmm. they have, especially in the UK, mm-hmm. they have the cadetship. You know, program,
yes.
especially for journalists and those going into the education management, they have that. And unless you have come to a certain point in your life when you can do it, really the way they want it done in the industry, then you just keep on studying until you learn. You know,
mm-hmm,
but
yes.
then they become very choosy as far as the personal capacities. And capabilities of the students are concerned. What else are the issues that you see?
Fiscal management, I think, is something that Mayor Duterte had included in his program.
Yes.
You know, I think all the candidates agree that we have the wealth, the minerals, and all the things that makes the country great. You know, mm-hmm. our renewable resources, number one of our renewable resources is people management. You You know, we've got, you know, a new generation. We're 100 million and growing. But where they disagree, or where one becomes better than the other, is in the management of resources. We talk about trillions and all that. But there is one vice president candidate who thinks that it's just an equation, you know, an algebraic resolutions of being able to, you know, distribute funds all over the country, and that solves the problem. No such thing.
Yeah.
Because one problem is that, you know, there's always inequity in the distribution of funds.
It's social inequity.
It's social inequity. And so that's addressed by Mayor Duterte. And that's, that he says, you know, federalism might perhaps make the problems smaller.
Yes.
That local government can address better than the national government.
Uh-huh.
And so this is something that will really, we talk about investments. Investors will be looking for better deals about the where the cost of electricity, cost of power will be cheaper than the other. So they don't deal with just one
government. And where the courts do not interfere.
Yeah, that's right.
In contracts, you know.
Yes, yes.
Yeah.
For example, in consultation with a renowned Filipino master planner.
Yeah.
He says, you know, one way to solve the problem of traffic in Metro Manila is to, you know, remove all the military camps out of Metro Manila.
Yes, yes.
And the schools be given options to establish in other parts of the country.
Yeah, decentralized.
Decentralized, exactly. And factories can be relocated where the source of energy is abound, you know, is plentiful and cheaper to generate. So the area of Ormoc, for example, where the geothermal has not been fully explored.
Yeah.
It's one, you know, Bacolod itself, you know, has rich geothermal resources.
And Canloan is right there.
Exactly. So this is the vision of Mayor Duterte. In order to say, it's like rezoning the whole country.
Uh-huh.
You know, tourism will be a natural beneficiary of, you know, relocating these things. In Manila, you notice that when it's holiday, there's no traffic, you know. So, and one thing that this master planner has observed is, you know, we are in a vulnerable spot in Metro Manila. A major earthquake can destroy the whole country because this is where the financial district is.
Yeah.
So by immediately acting on this, because this has been studied and restudied, but nothing has been doing. But I think with Mayor Duterte, he promises to see, you know, that action be taken immediately, because we cannot wait.
Okay, let me pose one question. The candidates, all of them, all five of them, are trying to address the common people, the bigger number of voters, because in a democracy like ours and in our system of elections, it's the numbers that count. It's a numbers game, you know. And so I do believe, correct me if I'm wrong and get your inputs in, and I would ask audiences to please phone in to Harry at any given time of the week, or email him to get your inputs in and ask questions, because this is one thing that will stand out. The people who count in the numbers game are the least informed people. The least informed people are the ones who can easily misunderstand even the body language of any candidate. And therefore, anybody who does not, in their perception, not necessarily logical, but in their perception, does not deliver, is immediately opposed.
Yeah.
I mean, this has happened in the banana republics of South America, whereby the populist or the popular candidate wins, and 3 months after, 2 months after, 1 week after, you know, there is already a demonstration and a move to get him out because he cannot deliver. You don't give me jobs, you know, that kind of thing. What does the youth think about this?
Actually, in terms of informing those who are really in the lower strata of the society, because I'm a nurse by profession, and we have been going to communities as well.
Yes. Yeah, that's good. Yes. Tell us what you find out.
One major issue is actually the healthcare system. There's certain politicians that would give medications to to a barangay, and then they would put their names on all of those medications. So that would linger to the community. They would say, oh, this politician is giving me, maybe this is the right choice. But they wouldn't know that that medication could be actually a donation by certain people. Sometimes sometimes other politicians would even hitch with an activity of a school, like of a private institution. And they would put certain posters or tarpaulins of their names with it. So what I'm saying is that in terms of information, it's actually going down to the grassroots, going to each community, and hearing what their issues are. And sometimes the basic issues are there: healthcare, food, and jobs. Those are just the three major issues that they would want to be addressed.
You're talking about problems in communications, because if you talk English to these people, they wouldn't understand you at all.
Yes.
You'll have to talk to them in their own dialect.
Correct.
Yeah. And know their culture, know the body language, know the do's and don'ts, you know, in their daily lives, to be able to get their confidence to start with, you know. Without their confidence, you're dead meat.
Correct.
That's what it is.
Correct.
Know? Now, did you find anything that make them demand for more, or make them dependent on you? Meaning, if you give them something, do they just, at the end of the day, just extend their hands, their palms, and say, okay, you're giving me this, give me some more? Have you found that?
Sadly, yes. Maybe, I believe we have this program as a four-piece, right? The downside of four-piece is that the community people would just tend to receive this subsidy and not work anymore, because they know that they're part of the four-piece, that they're secured and everything. So sometimes they would still ask for more. But there are also other community people that would still strive harder to at least augment their needs, even if they have this four-piece allocation.
And that goes back and impacts on the economy. You know, and the upgrading of the human resources. How would you deal with that?
Not I, but Mayor Duterte had spoken on this issue.
And
had addressed this issue. And his emphasis is on being able to empower people. No? Employment is important, but it's not being an employee and suffer the consequence of contractualization. You know, he's for upgrading the skills of people, making them entrepreneurs in their own right. So to him, I think the Department of Labor would really be something that he would look into to find the right person to run it. The present secretary had resigned, but hopefully the next administration would find somebody who could continue the good effort of Secretary Baldos. And TESDA is a very important skills training.
Yes.
We are exporting slot, you know, the they cut meat and all that sort of things. They are very attractive because they speak the language, they have the skills and all that to go to Europe, you know, and Australia. So these are areas where perhaps, you know, the thing about Mayor Duterte is pragmatic. You know, it would be unlike someone who would, with a deep, you know, grievance inside, you know, would not continue just because, you know, it started by the previous administration. No, he's pragmatic.
Okay.
He looks at issues that divides the people, and he says we have to move on.
Okay.
And so there are certain things that only a man like Duterte can do.
All right. Well, all things must end at a given time, you know. And really, 1 hour is not enough for this.
Yes, yes.
We must meet again sometime before the elections because of the importance of the issue.
Yes.
Now, let me give you a couple of minutes each to round up or sum up what you think is your message to the electors, to the voters. You can start.
Okay. Mayor Duterte is a rare candidate. He is one that speaks of issues close to his heart. He is loved, he's appreciated for what he is, and not, you know, the polite, courteous candidates that we used to elect. So in his roughness, you know, he came out with a 15-point legacy program, which I hope can see the light of day immediately after he gets elected. We can avoid a situation like the sad experience of South America, because this is a man who has an immediate agenda first hour that he sits in power. And one is, he wants to fund this program. And this is something that he would present to the both houses of Congress. And we know the alternative. If we cannot find cooperation and support from the two houses, you know, we may have a constitutional National Assembly, which shall draft a new constitution to bring about the programs and changes that he envisions for our country today. So this is important.
Okay. So your turn.
Yes.
You know?
Well, my fearless forecast is that the youth will be voting for only two candidates come few days before May 9. It's either Mayor Duterte or Senator Defensor Santiago. And at the end of the stretch of all of it, it still depends on the platform, because the youth today is a force to reckon with. And this 40% of the voting population, we could really make a change. And it still depends on whom we will be choosing and on their platforms and on their promises that they must be able to succeed once they become a president.
So and your advice to your fellow millennials?
Well, my advice to my fellow millennials, be vigilant with this coming election, because it's very sensationalized. And I believe we can make a difference with every vote that we will be casting.
Okay. We had consumed 1 hour. And like I said, this is not enough. But we have to have one more session. Hopefully, we'd be able to get it, you know, depending on the time constraints. Now, let me sum up what we have done over the last hour. Number one, we have gone through the issues that we believe are very, very important and will impact on the lives of our nation, on the lives of our people in the next 6 years or after this election. Whoever gets elected, you know, whichever team. Number two is, there seemed to be a popular move towards federalism. Why? Because it is good economically. It is going to empower the provinces. It is going to empower the people, upgrade the human resources. And we should be able to, depending on how we are going to implement or let people follow the rules of federalism, get our maximize our resources, although they're limited, without spending or debasing the environment. Because whatever we do, you know, remember we signed 2 weeks ago, we signed the Paris conference on the environment, and that is going to be part of the law of the land because we signed it. And the moment 55 other nations sign that, it's going to be effective already in all the 152 countries that signed it. Number three, the economy is something that we must be looking at very, very closely. The youth of today, like Guillermo has told us, is very, very much informed. And what you are now looking at is they are scrutinizing all the issues very well. On top of all this, it needs an effective communicator to be able to have this cascade all the way down to the grassroots. And most important, if you elect the president and vice president, you must also have to elect the legislature, the members of Congress, both houses, to be able to support the program of the government. Therefore, please vote for people who have the same thinking, who whose minds travel on the same channel, so that we can look at a better future of our country, at least for the next 6 years, or the foundation is laid down for the next 25 years. Thank you very much, and this is Gil Santos, pinch hitting for Harry. We'll see you next week. Talk to Harry. Thank you very much.
You are what you watch.